did not finish creation.
A big part of the film and a big key element was Vietnam.
Vietnam in particular is very special because it's never been captured on film before in this way.
And action!
We're really trying to create a place that is incredibly distinctive and unique and never seen before. And we're one of the first films to shoot in Vietnam on this scale.
The decision to sort of say, let's take our whole crew, let's take the actors there, let's not just shoot plates there, let's go.
I've moved from Phong Nha to Ninh Binh, and Eugene has a Vietnamese house.
Yeah, I'm rocking all of it.
Okay.
Oh, man. Blood.
Yeah. Oh, wait, that's pretty, huh?
Good morning, Vietnam. How's it going?
Became very clear very quickly that this was a place we could put on film and make audiences go, wow.
Toi da bui, he day and day.
This is where the new chapter begins. Probably the most spectacular location. No offense, Hawaii and Australia. But this is new territory, places unseen. See you there.
We are in an area called Quang Binh Province. It's central Vietnam, and this specific area is called Than Hoa. It's mostly a farm community, and you can get these incredible vast landscapes, 360-degree, you know, views with not a structure in sight.
You know, for most Americans, their primary touchstone of Vietnam is obviously the war. Most of those photos took place in the South, and it's a very different landscape in the South. And you go up into northern Vietnam, it looks like a map painting. It looks like something someone created in a computer.
This is bananas. This is gonna be absolutely insane.
You already?
You walk out your door sometimes, or you step out of a van and you see shapes and landscapes that you didn't know existed in nature.
It's beautiful. Are you kidding me? Look at this. This is unbelievable.
I could totally understand now why Jordan was set on really wanting to shoot here. Vietnam has been truly breathtaking.
2, 1, go!
That's awesome.
I haven't been ceased to be amazed yet, but after this, I think it all stops, because this is amazing. Like, you don't find places like this on Earth, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. If you get halfway up a staircase in rural Vietnam and no one's around to hear it, did it really happen?
My favorite thing really has been meeting the people. They're just so friendly and warm and excited to see us, and they know it's King Kong, and they're pretty excited about it.
I mean, front row seats, right?
We have never seen such a beautiful and handsome actor.
Surely.
They're very warm people, the Vietnamese. Very warm indeed. So sweet and welcoming, and hospitality is a big thing for them, and it's refreshing to see that.
People and the food and the atmosphere and the culture, they're all amazing. And so it's this perfect package of just this untapped place in the world that I don't think a lot of people have thought about traveling to. No one's ever shot a movie like this in Vietnam. And to me, that's a point of pride. Like, hopefully people see this movie and they're saying, oh my God, where was that?
Oh my God, so much fun. This is why we came to Vietnam.
And we just truly fell in love with the culture, the people, and everything about this country. And the places there are, they're just spectacular.
Leg. We've done 42 days here. It's been absolutely extraordinary. Hawaii is one of the most beautiful places on the planet. My first day, so we went up in real helicopters and real 70s Hueys flying over the Pacific.
It's gonna be fun.
Hey,
how fast do we want to be going?
Things you don't normally get to do in life, let alone in movies.
If not, I'll go to the water. Okay.
You could see all the way through. My eyes are like, I kind of feel like I'm gonna throw up, but I'm also really happy.
This is the gambling den we've just shot Conrad's introduction into the film.
I didn't go home, but then that fire.
Now there's a man worth talking to.
That's what we did. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a wrap on our adventures in Hawaii. It's given us lots of sunsets and blue skies and a lot of laughs. We can't wait to see what they have in store for us down under. We'll see you there. This is me at Calvero Hair Department. We're having a conversation about how sweaty I should be. I mean, it's pretty hot out here. It's about 85 degrees. Queensland, Australia, paper bark forest. I feel like I'm gonna get sweaty. Australia is, I find, it's my first time really exploring the forests of Australia, but it's so wild. There are more creatures, more bugs, more creeper crawlies, more snakes, more spiders. What was that bird? Did you hear that bird? There's a bird that was like in the trees going.
Will you hang a little further back, so.
That's calm.
Good, cut it.
Cut.
Who's that?
This is Corey Hawkins.
I'm Houston Brooks.
This is Houston Brooks.
Sorry.
He's wearing a very fetching sleeveless.
This is a military
puffer jacket. This is carrying burritos through the jungle.
It's important, man. We got a mission to accomplish.
We are here in a place called Ninbin, which is one of our locations for Skull Island. And I'm sitting on a boat. Here she is. She's called the Grey Fox. And in the film, she belongs to Lieutenant Hank Marlowe, who's played by John C. Reilly. She's a sturdy old girl, and today's the day that we take the Grey Fox away from its moorings and deeper into the jungle on Skull Island.
In case anyone was wondering was driving the boat that whole time.
Yeah. Nice. She's out of focus. The Ely village isn't focused. There we go. Yeah.
Don't quit your day job.
Okay. Brie Larson.
Yeah.
How do you feel?
How am I feeling? It's a combination of feelings, you know? I'm feeling excited to be moving away from this mud, but also sad to be saying goodbye to these Iwis.
Do you think in another world you'd like to move to this Iwi village?
As long as there's like margarita capabilities and a way to charge my Game Boy, I'm fine here.
Yeah.
Leave me here, actually. I love it here. Look at that, and they're so sweet. They're so happy all the time. I love these Iwis. And I think they love me too.
Most people do when they come to Vietnam, you know. Just see the sights and run through a swamp, as you do in Vietnam.
The best part of working in Vietnam has been the locations, to be honest. The places we have seen, the places we've shot in, are places that have never been photographed on film in the way that they are being now. And the food has been good. The food's been great. So Vietnam's been wonderful. I recommend it.
All right. That's it. That's a wrap.
Now it's a wrap on the end there.
Oh, Captain Conrad, signing off.
My name is Jordan Vogt Roberts. I'm the director of Kong Skull Island. I just wanted to give a little bit of context to these amazing photos that Brie Larson took, because she is a true artist. And it was just really important to me that in this film, what she was doing with the camera felt authentic and felt real. And so not only did we sort of set her up with war correspondents and photojournalists, but even just like the way that Leica camera works is super complicated. It's not like the most intuitive thing in the world. And so just, you know, whether it was her in the darkroom and the way she ran her hands through the loop, or, you know, sort of was developing those photos, you know, the way she was dealing with the camera, it could just need to feel authentic. And so not only did we want to send her through a lot of training so it showed on screen and she knew how to do this stuff, but it was really important to me that she knew how to use that camera. And so when the props people came to me and said, like, oh, the camera doesn't need to be a working camera, right? It's way easier to get a camera that's not a working camera. It can be lighter, it can be a rubber. And I was like, no. And actually, like, it's very important that not only is it a working camera, but I want film in that camera at all times. I want Brie to, like, have the freedom to actually be taking photos on set. I want her to be able to sort of, like, find these moments. And whether they are just things for fun, whether they end up in the film, you know, I want her to have that ability to, like, run. And because she's such an immense talent and has such a great eye. And I just wanted to, like, always sort of give her that challenge of saying, hey, there's film in this camera. Like, you really want to walk away having shot for 90 days and have shot one roll of film? Or, like, you know, do you want to find those small moments? Like, this whole movie was about finding moments, and I just wanted to give Brie that freedom. I was so excited that when I pitched Brie the idea, it would be really easy for an actor to be like, I don't know. But when I came to her and said, hey, I want to put film in this camera, and I want you to dive in, and I want you to know this stuff, and I want you to take these photos and just have fun with it, you know, for her, she was like, yes, please. You know, and you just never know how that's going to go. And so I'm just psyched that she took that idea and really went off to the races with it.
Grand
Brenda told me myth can be more than just stories handed down through the generations or words on a page. Myth can be a compass. Ancient tribes of Oceania all had their own story, but the name is woven throughout history of a place existing far beyond the natural laws of our world. Skull Island.
Driven by his experiences upon the SS Lawton, Supervisor William Randa searched for a mythic island, an obsession that lasted close to 30 years. A multitude of terra searches were commissioned, but none were successful until the advent of Landsat. Through their imaging satellite, the island number 11002039543 was located on April 7th, 1973. A joint mission between Monarch and Landsat was launched. We engaged the services of a military helicopter squadron for passage and extraction from the island. This mission suffered massive casualties, including the loss of Randa. However, Monarch operatives Brooks and San survived, returning with their eyewitness accounts and Randa's original field notes. In many ways, the expedition was a success. We discovered a whole new ecosystem, an island of Mutos. None more significant than those hereafter noted as Kong and the Skull Crawlers. During the 1973 mission, Monarch operatives Brooks and San discovered native islanders called the Iwi. The following intel comes from their interactions with the tribe, as well as Lieutenant Hank Marlowe, who lived with the Iwi until his escape from the island. Marlowe's recollections of the Iwi reveal a complex system of communication that also serves as a mode of camouflage from the beasts that inhabit the island. Symbols are written upon their flesh and woven into their clothing. There is very little spoken language, but many subtle gestures that speak volumes. Wrecks of several ships and airplanes lay scattered near their encampment. Some of the vessels appear to be quite ancient, dating back millennia. It has been proposed that the Iwi are not indigenous to the area, but are travelers themselves who were stranded on the island at various points in time. The Iwi scavenge parts to build structures, but mainly appear to use the ships as shrines to the god they call Kong, the alpha superspecies of the island.
The superspecies is far beyond the size limitations of any primate seen on Earth. This is no ape. This is something else. To the indigenous population of Skull Island, Kong is more than just an animal. Kong is a god. And frankly, who are we to argue? Now, I've never been much a believer in God, but I believe in Kong. Darwin had it easy. This island is beyond classification. Relationships are so pronounced in their aggression that they drove evolution down a completely different path. These beasts, like a fusion of plant and animal, not flora yet not fauna, but something new. It's flora fauna. On Skull Island, myth truly runs wild. I, Houston Brooks, geological advisor to Monarch, hereby state on record that the myth is real. We found it. Skull Island exists, and it's more wondrous and more terrifying than any myth could ever hope to communicate.
The discovery of the island reveals an ecosystem teeming with a multitude of Mutos, something our scientists had never anticipated. According to Randa's notes, the discovery of the island reveals a self-contained biome in which the path of evolution has skewed into a dramatic new tangent, manifesting life forms that are unlike anything on our planet. There is gigantism beyond any megafauna previously identified. The mammalian life has grown to a scale beyond anything typically found within phenotype. Those who experienced this new world firsthand had similar reactions. Randa reported,
"This planet doesn't belong to us. Ancient species owned this Earth long before mankind."
Part of Monarch's mission is to locate, study, and preserve the unexplained orders of nature hidden in remote corners of the world. As such, Skull Island creates a unique challenge for our organization. There are two alpha species of Muto on the island. These are in direct opposition to one another. The apex primate Kong and the hypervore species referred to as Skull Crawlers.
In so many ways, the island is like something from a dream, but these things, they walk out of a nightmare. If Kong is the god of the mountain, then this beast is the devil incarnate.
Operative Brooks's hollow earth theories were tested when the team arrived on the island. The seismic charges released revealed the bedrock to be practically hollow. Unfortunately, this experimentation flushed the skull crawlers out of their subterranean spaces and into direct conflict with the team.
They call it the skull crawler. Its hypermetabolism is so accelerated that the creature exists in a constant state of starvation, always hunting, always devouring, and that cold, lifeless skull just stares into your soul. The boneyard is massive, filled with the skeletal remains of every apex predator that got in the Skullcrawler's way. This isn't just a graveyard, it's a feeding ground. We walk through the bones of Kong's ancestors like walking in the shadow of fallen gods. These things may have made Kong the last of his kind.
We are fascinated with monsters. They simultaneously attract and repel us. They arouse fear in us, but we keep trying to engage with them. So there's a kind of connection between us and monsters that, you know, just can't be avoided.
What I like about monster stories is that there's something out there and you don't quite know what it is. It's mysterious and you're filled with wonder. So you can't help but go towards it, but also it could be dangerous.
Monsters represent things that we are, as a society, told to think of as taboo or forbidden in some way, things we're not supposed to do. But who hasn't had those moments of wanting to do things you're not supposed to do? So monsters attract us precisely because they represent the forbidden.
If you could put yourself in the place of a primitive human many thousands of years ago, the only light you got is from the campfire, and beyond that campfire is the darkness that's inhabited by monsters. Now take yourself down into a cave where maybe the shaman has drawn these wonderful pictures of saber-toothed cats and bears and dire wolves and woolly rhinoceros. And by the flickering torchlight, it would seem that these pictures were coming to life, and it's as if the mental ghosts of the things that would have given our ancestors nightmares are still with us.
Monster stories have been around forever. The earliest story we have is like the Epic of Gilgamesh, and even in the Epic of Gilgamesh, there's a monster. Gilgamesh has to fight a creature called Humbaba. And ever since then, religion and literature and folklore has been filled with monsters. I think it's a way in which different cultures process and handle their own fears.
Monsters represent the collective fears of the unknown. We come up with these different monsters, whether it be Godzilla or Kong, because we know that there's something else out there that is stronger than us, that we aren't really in control as much as we think we are.
Humans have always needed ways of exploring and responding to their primal fears. And that's just as true today as it was centuries ago.
The fear of monsters is so prevalent that it makes one think that it might be hardwired into the human mind. We see it in little children early on. We see it all over the planet. So it looks like the kind of thing that might be part of the architecture of human thinking and cognition. It might be in the brain, so to speak.
There is a deep set origin point in all of us with monsters, which is, I think, every kid, long before they're dreaming about the heroes flying overhead, they're thinking about the monsters that are under their bed.
Our primitive ancestors lived on the plains of East Africa. They were preyed on by crocodiles, big cats, wild dogs. So this fascination with monsters, I think, is an ancestral survival tactic. It's been passed on, if you like, as a fossil memory.
We've all inherited this operating system of fear that has saved the species, really. So when we see something frightening like a predator, we don't have to think about it and theorize it. We run. The body was built like this to keep us alive. And then we live in a sophisticated cultural world with air conditioning and central heating and lighting, and we're very far removed from the kind of African savanna where we evolved. But we still have this old operating system, sort of the reptile brain, the limbic system, and it's just aching to be activated. And so we find cultural ways to activate this fight or flight mechanism. And I think monster stories and monster movies are giving us a little roller coaster ride for the brain.
If you examine legends worldwide, you will find something that I have christened the global monster template. Every culture has its monsters. Take, for instance, the great-great-granddaddy of all the monsters, the dragon. It appears in all cultures on Earth, cultures that were never connected.
Whether it was South America, Asia, Europe, even Native Americans, you'll find dragons.
The dragon is very popular and known in the West as something that knights will fight. But of course, it goes way back into Chinese history as well.
If you look at the dragons from Eastern cultures, they're actually seen as benevolent forces.
Slaying dragons is a Western concept. In the East, they're sacred, divine creatures who brought wisdom, strength, even redemption.
Dragons become what you might call a sticky meme. It's a meme that replicates all through culture. It's sticky in that sense because it's so exciting and weird and interesting that I want to look at it again, and I want to tell you about it, and you want to tell your friends. And in that way, dragons seem to be very sticky memes in the East and in the West. Sea monsters are actually very common all over the world. Sailors would come back with these stories of things they'd, you know, half seen that didn't know what it was. You see these in the drawings of sea monsters. So cryptozoology and the idea of creatures out there that we don't know about came to be a huge sort of genre.
Cryptozoology is the study of hidden or unknown animals. Animals that have not been verified, have not been discovered. They're still on the fringes of zoology.
It's the science that looks at creatures that are as yet unknown to science, ones that are thought to be extinct but may still be lingering around, and ones of known species that have grown to fantastical dimensions.
Cryptozoology is not necessarily a field which is taken very seriously in the scientific community. Personally, I'm a fan of it. I wouldn't mind taking a few years off and having some adventures in that field myself.
Every once in a while, cryptozoology turns out to actually deliver a real animal.
There have been many animals thought to be purely mythological that were documented by science. These include the kraken, a giant squid from Norse maritime mythology. And of course, this was thought to be a complete fiction until they started turning up in the 1870s.
Off the coast of New England in the 1800s, a lot of reports of this giant tentacled creature. It was big and mean. There was reports of it coming up on boats and attacking boats. And so the giant squid was discovered.
Just when you think you know everything that's out there, science actually does dredge up some creature that you've never seen before.
A lot of people don't believe in dragons, but we know dragons exist. In the 1920s, a man had a crash on the island of Komodo, and he saw these giant lizards that were over 6 feet tall that were eating babies, they were eating pigs, and the Komodo dragon was discovered.
And there are reports today of lizards several times larger than the Komodo dragon haunting the forests of New Guinea. Creatures like the mountain gorilla, the okapi, the coelacanth, the megamouth shark, they are all relatively recent discoveries. And that begs the question, what else is out there?
Humans have always been fascinated by monsters. And what has happened in, let's say, in the last couple hundred years is that we're moving into the modern world of monsters.
Monster stories have been around forever, but now we've got film, and I think this does change the monster story.
Cinema is a new part of the tradition of monster telling stories that has existed for thousands of years.
There's a sense in which contemporary filmmaking and monster movies, well, they have an opportunity that previous storytellers never had, and I think that's really quite magical.
Senators, if we hope to survive, we must find ways to coexist with Titans, with Godzilla.
A sort of symbiotic relationship, if you will.
We introduced an organization called Monarch, which is really the gateway, the human gateway into the Monsterverse, which is this universe where these Titan iconic monster characters battle against one another and battle with us against other foes as well.
Characters like Godzilla and Kong and Ghidorah and Mothra, these giant monoliths of pop culture, they are the modern myths that we want to bring to the big screen. So with the Monsterverse going forward, we are building a universe that can bring these towering characters, literally towering characters, to the big screen and have them interact and collide in ways that audiences have never seen before.
All monsters reflect the fears of their age, and movie monsters in particular, because they're projecting them to a wider audience. And the monster is constructed in a particular cultural period by the fears of the audience.
Godzilla is made at a time when the culture is absolutely horrified by the recent explosions, Hiroshima, Nagasaki. This is a world in which a nuclear threat was a reality and horrifying for people who lived through it.
The kinds of monsters that last are monsters whose story is flexible enough that it can deal with new kinds of situations. Godzilla, born in the aftermath of World War II, connected to the atom bomb, can yet metamorphose to be a figure for the kind of ecological interest, the worries about climate change and things that are bothering us now.
More than ever now, the human race, who are the real monsters at the end of the day, are destroying the world.
Humans have been the dominant species for thousands of years, and look what's happened. Overpopulation, pollution, war. The mass extinction we feared has already begun, and we are the cause. We are the infection.
The relationship between mankind and nature is central to really all giant monster films, whether it's Godzilla, Kong, Beast from 20,000 Fathoms. They all have a very similar message, which is that Mother Nature will strike back.
And for us to modernize that, we really wanted to treat it as an allegory for global warming and climate change. Godzilla represents nature fighting back.
I mean, theoretically, you could take out the word Godzilla and just apply the word nature. You know, we have to form a symbiotic relationship with Godzilla slash nature. We must find ways to live with Godzilla slash nature. Because to me, that's what he's always represented. He's Mother Nature's 800 megaton gorilla. And Mother Nature, when threatened, will unleash Godzilla against whatever might be a threat, whether that be other monsters or us. There's a very deep and soulful intent to Godzilla underneath all the monster mayhem, whether it's about the horrors of atomic warfare or the threat to the environment that mankind can hold. It has a sort of mythic purpose.
It is really something about being human. that asks us to sort of rehearse and think about our greatest fears and then develop a story in which they can sort of be handled or conquered. And when I do research on monsters, whether it's the latest Hollywood film or whether it's, you know, something in Aristotle's theory of monsters, I feel connected to this ancient human tradition.
People who are sitting in a cinema watching a modern monster movie are engaging in precisely the same exploration of fear and terror and things that scare us as their ancestors were. It doesn't matter that we're doing it in a modern medium, it's the same process.
Sitting in the dark with an audience at a monster movie, we can think about it almost like sitting in the dark with our caveman tribe and people telling stories as the saber-toothed tiger roars in the background there. The sense of telling a story as a way, as almost as a mantra against fear, against the possibility of death, against the monstrous there. I mean, I think it just goes to some kind of human essence, an essence in human history that goes directly from that caveman situation to the situation of sitting in the dark with people that we don't know watching a monster movie.